Hi, I'm JK with Amplify and this is Blitz Kids. So do you want to go through and say who you all are and what you do then?
I'm Jono, I play guitar.
You can take the microphone, so.
I'm Joe and I sing.
I'm Nick and I play the bass.
Okay, so for a start, why did you pick the band name Blitz Kids?
It was your idea.
It was my granddad was in World War II, and his group of mates that he was in was like a little gang, and they called themselves Blitz Kids because they used to just muck about, and when like bombs were being dropped and stuff in England, in London where he lived, then he would just run out and just sort of like throw paper airplanes around and kick a football and just kind of like play in the rubble and just be very irresponsible, and that was their little gang name. So I thought that was really cool.
That actually makes sense, really. So, you guys are, you could say, pretty big now. You've played loads of festivals and toured with, like, We the Kings and all that, haven't you?
We have.
So, what do you guys think got you there, like, to that level?
Hard work. Just slogging it out, even when it's the worst. The worst. We've played, we've, for, like, you know, like, for six of the, no, for five of the 6 years we've been together, it has been pretty grim. Like, just playing the worst sort of venues. Not the worst venues, but like, you know, to nobody, just to the sound guy, and the other bands if they stick around after their set. But in the past kind of 18 months, we've seen like a big pickup because, I mean, I think our music's changed quite a lot and we've become actually not terrible. I think we got where we were before because we met all the other bands in the scene and they thought we were good guys, so they gave us a chance. But like the fans kind of didn't really like the music so much. But now we're actually making.
We were really experimental and we were really. Like, we the music that we made, whilst we liked it, it was
niche.
It was very niche. Yeah, it was like there was only a few people that really got it and really understood what we were trying to do. I don't think we really understood what we were trying to do. And I guess we've just continued to be a band and continued to tour and continued to develop as musicians. And somewhere along that line, it just started to pick up and people started to take interest. And you know. We just kind of got a manager, then got an agent, then got a label, and it just kind of
fell organically
happened.
We just threw everything in the air and it landed perfectly.
So yeah, I wouldn't say there's no formula or anything. We just
it's just working hard.
I would say just don't give up. And if you really want it, then don't give up because
and be prepared to sacrifice.
We did not, and it's worked out.
Be prepared to sacrifice everything.
Yes,
money.
You'll never see your friends.
Family.
You'll never see your friends, and you will never see. Your girlfriend, if you have a girlfriend, and
boyfriend,
you just be prepared to sacrifice a lot and just don't give up
for the greater good.
So then, you guys have said you've had some pretty bad times. What's the best thing that's happened on a tour or like at a festival? Naturally, we're a youth organisation, so keep it child friendly. But what's the best thing you can say that's happened?
I remember the first time I kind of felt that things were starting to pick up was we played Guildfest. And like, and it was like we had a full tent, and this is like in 2011, I think, when the album had just our first album had just come out, and Joe, like every night, Joe's like, oh, so who's heard of us before? Expecting like you know a few people to be like, hey, and the whole tent just went mental. I was just on stage, just like, I don't know if everyone was just out of their minds. everyone seemed to like
forget about that festival sometimes, but that really was a sort of like
turning point, wasn't it?
Yeah, I'd say that would be the first point when we actually played a show where there was like a full room and like people were like singing back to us and stuff. Mm. Up until that point, it was kind of just like our friends would come to shows and things like that.
We'd organise buses and stuff, and like we'd have to obviously a lot of people
force them to go.
Yeah, a lot of people are like a lot of promoters in big cities where you're not from are like, oh, you need to sell. You know, 30 plus or 40 plus tickets.
Yeah, they wouldn't give you the show unless you'd shift 50 tickets.
And
we just bought a bus. We didn't buy a bus. We rented a bus and then charged people like travel and ticket price and stuff. And it's very corporate.
Yeah.
Worked though.
40 quid each.
Yeah. We had to pay out of our own money to do that, and then he got all our mates there, and then it just was a good show. But when there are people there that you don't know, who are there just to watch your band, it kind of reality check, and it's like, alright, we're doing something right.
Right, fun one now. Describe each other, but you can't describe yourself. For example, you two will describe you, and you two will describe you, and you two will describe you. Have fun.
Okay. Let's do Nick first.
All right.
Nick is
very handsome, isn't he?
Charming. He's very charming.
Fashionable.
He's very fashionable.
On trend.
Yep. and he's just a joker.
Yeah.
He can always make you laugh.
He's a clown.
Constantly.
Oh, clown, am I?
The jester.
Rarely sad. If Nick's sad, then it makes me sad because he's never really sad. Mm. You know, when he gets in the van and he's sad, I'm like, oh no, something must be wrong. Because yeah. He's never really sad, he's always happy.
That's true.
And, yep, I think that's enough.
On the inside, he's dead, like cold.
It's all the front. Yes. All right, now let's do Jono.
Jono.
Unreliable.
Horrid.
Always late.
Hold on.
What is that?
Jono is well endowed. Personality, I don't know what you.
You have a full bodied personality.
Yeah.
Jono can make can meet anybody and make them feel comfortable immediately when he starts talking to them.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter who it is, they'll just feel comfortable talking to him. He's extremely fickle. In terms of what he says he's going to do and then what he doesn't, what he does.
Best thing ever, we have to do yeah. Right now.
This song is the best song I've ever heard in my entire life. Like a week later, like, this song is the best song I've ever heard in my entire life.
Miley Cyrus needs to stop releasing songs. Or else I'm going to say it every week.
No, I'll give you that.
He doesn't know what he wants, bless him, and he's a lover, so he loves everything and he thinks that everything is the best thing in the world ever.
Which isn't a bad quality.
No. And... yeah, he's funny. He's really funny.
And also the love of my life.
You guys.
And he's got he's got really animated eyebrows, which I love. All right.
Let's Joe.
Joe James.
Let's roast this guy. Roasting so hard right now.
Oh, yeah. Hey, do you need to be late? Because I know Joe.
Joe is a perfectionist, almost to a fault.
Absolutely.
Well, to a fault.
Yes.
It's terrible. Nothing is good enough.
He never puts his phone on silent.
Never puts his phone on silent. Always disrupts interviews with Popular. Texts.
He's a very monotone fellow. I don't know if you've noticed thus far.
Mm. I rarely move from this tone.
Unless when he sings, he has the full audible spectrum.
I save everything for singing.
I think he needs to save on the range, so he uses it to day by day go in the same tone.
Yeah.
I think that's about right.
Just lazy. Can't be bothered to make an effort with talking. I may as well just stay down here.
The most unanimated man. So 2D.
Joe James, very 2D.
Yeah, so that's us.
You've all been very nice to each other, I'll say that. So, who do you guys idolise, if anybody, like...
Miley Cyrus.
I think we can all agree on that one, can't we? Definitely Miley Cyrus.
I want to befriend.
I would befriend. If she sent me a friend request, I would say...
Except.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Except. And I would tick close acquaintances instead of...
I would tick...
Close friends instead of acquaintances.
In a relationship with.
Family.
So no, that's a whole different...
whole different ball game.
I idolise Pharrell Williams because he is a great man. And I think everyone can learn from him.
Yes, I think...
He's a really good dude, he works hard and he's really talented and he's a good down-to-earth person. A personal close friend of mine. No, I'm kidding. I wish it was.
Who's your guitar idol, Jono?
I don't listen to any like guitar bands really.
But just guitar.
Simon Neil, probably. Just because he's the innovation.
Just leave it at that. He's the innovation.
Right, he is.
Hi, Simon.
He is the innovation.
Yeah, he is. So.
Yeah, I'd say that's a good one. What about bass? Who's your favourite bassist?
My favourite bass player ever is Carl Alvarez from a band called The Descendants.
Great second name.
Good God. Strong. I know. Such a strong
bassist.
Him and Bill Stevenson, those grooves.
Oh, what a rhythm section. Yeah, what phenomenal. A pair of chaps.
Comparable only to our rhythm section, Nick Montgomery and the Iceman.
Which, in comparison, is pedantic. Shallow and pedantic.
Mine's Freddie Mercury because he's a lad. Was. Next question.
Okay then, so do you guys prefer to have studio time or to be out playing gigs, and why?
Both for different reasons, really. So getting holed up in the studio is great, and like, it's always good to be like making new music and stuff, but it's also just as much of a buzz to like play that new music to a lot of people, and also going out on the road and just having a good time with the lads. But you have a good time with the lads in the studio as well, so like, for me,
yours is both.
Mine's definitely both.
Mine's live, I think, and I think yours is studio.
Mine is exactly between the two. There are things I love and hate about both, but they are the best things about being in a band.
Yeah, easily. Being in the studio. Playing live and being in the studio, there's two best things.
There isn't press.
Yeah.
It's good. Is that your final answer? So, you've been going for a long time. What sort of process do you go through to write your songs, and has it changed over the years?
Yes, it has changed. In a big way.
Dramatically.
I'll tell you how it's changed. When we first started off, we used to write music first of all, and then I would put vocals over the top of it, which is quite difficult because it feels like you're constantly running after a moving vehicle and you can't really catch up because the song's already been written without you. That was the old way. Out with the old, in with the new. Now I write it first and I make them chase me. I do all the vocals first and then I give it to them and then they make music underneath it, and it's loads better, I think we can all agree.
It's easier to catch.
Yes.
Very easy.
Okay then, so how do you guys...
Sorry.
How do you deal with writer's block whenever you get that?
It's never happened.
Just stop.
Don't just stop and go in the
don't,
pool.
Don't try and push the barrier because you'll just end up writing something.
I thought you meant just stop writing then.
Stop writing for like, if you got writer's block, just, you know, if you have a bad day or whatever, just like stop for the day, take a break, take a chill, and then you'll probably, the songs will come to you at the end of the
we
day.
We generally find that the songs we have to force the most on
the worst
the best.
Songs.
Yeah. The ones that come quickly are the ones that I'm sorry.
Go on. Finish strong.
The ones that get cast out first.
Yeah.
Okay then, so advice for, I know you've given a few tips, but advice for upcoming bands, Blitz Kids top 5 tips.
Okay. Number 5. Don't release anything until you're 100% happy with what you've released. Number 4. Make sure you're really, really tight live. Like, don't play live until you're like really tight, because you never know who's going to watch you, and you never know who's going to like watch you once and then not come and watch you again. Like, make sure you're really tight before you play live. 3. Go on, someone help me out.
Buy a tuner. Nothing worse than watching a band who don't.
I thought you meant the fish then.
No.
Yeah, they're only 60 quid.
3. Make sure, I mean, if you can't afford gear, then borrow it, but like, just do your best to like try and save up and buy gear that's decent and will sound good, because that's going to help you a lot with recording and with live.
Gear isn't everything, but it certainly helps.
Yeah.
To make sure that you're in a band with people that you like and you want to be in a band with them for a long time.
Tried and tested.
Make sure they're your friends and that you're close and that you can, you know, you can do something like this for a long time, because you're going to be on the road with them forever if you make it. Like, you know, you're going to have to be in a van with these guys for ages. And 1, don't take it too seriously. It's supposed to be fun.
Be nice.
So if you don't enjoy it, then there's no point. So
all else, just be nice to
be
people.
Be sound.
Be nice to people, because
never get ahead of yourself and think that you're better than you are, because you're probably not. So just be a sound person and be nice and be friendly to all the bands you play with, because you never know where those bands are going to go or where you're going to go. You know.
There's some music in the background, in case you can't hear it through the microphone. So, would you rather be able to fly or breathe underwater?
Fly.
Fly. Why?
Fly, because even if you could breathe underwater, it doesn't really matter that much, because if you really want to explore the depths, then...
If you could deal with the pressure as well.
That's it, you see. There we go. It's going to get all science on, y'all.
I would definitely choose fly, because I could probably steal some super gear from somewhere and do that.
Yeah.
That's fair.
Now we've got a party.
Calm it down, lads. Cheers. Oh.
Tom's having a rave in there.
It's an even trade-off for me because I hate flying and I hate being under the sea. So let's say I can fly not very high.
Why not just fly normally and just not go high? Just be like, just stay down here.
But like keeping it chill.
Just hover yourself 5 feet off the ground and then just move it a bit.
But would I fly along with the M6? Like if I was trying to get paid, like just gently above car, like maybe sort of as far above.
Sat in a wheelchair. Just like gliding with some paper wings attached to the side.
As long as I can, you know.
And streamers
behind.
It's like
a really politically incorrect Tron. Go.
Right then. So, on the theme of films, if you could be any character out of a film, book, TV show, or comic, or anything like that, who would you be?
Deadpool.
Wow, that's fast.
Yeah, Deadpool's amazing.
Had that one in the chamber. Yeah.
Deadpool's the greatest comic book character of all time. So,
fair enough.
Yeah, fair enough. What are you gonna?
I was gonna say not depicted in
no
X-Men Origins. Yeah.
No, that's terrible.
Not in that Wolverine movie.
We don't
class that as Deadpool. No. That wasn't Deadpool.
Ryan Reynolds is
a heinous crime against cinema.
What was it? And they released another one.
I know, and it's even worse. It's absolutely worse.
Is it?
There's a really giant robot ninja, and you think like he squares up to him, and you think like, oh, it's gonna be sick, and then you think, no, it's not, because it's Hugh Jackman against CGI that is inevitably going to lose.
All I can see when they do that is a big green room where there's no one except a guy covered in like baubles, being like, oh, Hugh Jackman's like, he doesn't have the claws, he's going like, against this guy, he's like, oh, and everyone stood around really awkward going, this is going to look great.
Yeah. Everyone's just like, it'll look
okay, we've got the shot, that's a wrap. It's like, no, you don't.
Post-production's going to be great.
Yeah.
I would be Iron Man.
Oh, you dick. You dick.
You Richard. You bloody Richard.
Maybe I... no, stole it.
You can be War Machine.
Why would you want to be Iron Man?
War Machine.
Because...
Robert Downey Jr.
Because you're Robert Downey Jr. and he has sick life.
That's why Iron Man himself... sucks.
Oh, no, he doesn't. Wrong? Oh, am I wearing a sick metallic suit that can't be penetrated by anything?
Steady on.
Hold on. Youth music. Iron Man is sick. Iron Man is sick.
I would kick the hell out of you if you were Deadpool.
I'd stand
on the top of a mountain. You'd be like, I've got to scale this mountain to beat him. And as you started to walk, the mountain would break in half and swallow you.
Do you agree? What do you think? Iron Man or Deadpool?
I'd say Deadpool. It just break the comic.
There you go. That four fall down, mate.
Blah, blah, blah.
Next question.
Okay. Right then. Oh, wait. You've not said...
You've not said your person.
Well... Or is it just two Iron Mans?
Two Iron Men, yeah.
Then we beat you.
Iron Man War Machine. No War Machine. No, I am Patriot. That's right, I'm keeping up with the recent movie.
Film that was.
Terrible film. Great superhero, though.
Alright then, so who...
Spider-Man, change my mind. I would always be Spider-Man. Holy shit. Holy poop, I didn't think about that before.
Okay, what people in the music industry would you most like to do a collaboration with?
Whoever this artist is.
I hope the bleed on this microphone's not good.
Fast forward, selector. Oh, this is bad. Right, okay. Who would we like to collaborate with? I fancy collaborating with the Neptunes.
Yeah, all right, nice.
Kendrick Lamar.
I go Butch Walker. I've got a little bit of a session this week.
All of them?
Yeah, all the songwriters.
Kendrick Lamar, Neptunes, and Butch Walker, and us.
We call
bases. Yeah. And we would only do covers.
Of the band bases.
Right then. So what's the best thing that you could say has ever happened at a gig, you know, like people singing back or crowd surfers or something else?
About last week,
I'd say it's probably last week in Edinburgh. I got a conga line in one of the, I said breakdown, it's not really a breakdown, is it? It's just like the middle eighth instrumental part of one of our songs, I got a conga line going with maybe 50 people in it, and it went all the way around the sound desk and outside and by the bar. And then when it came back, they all lined up in a row and did some sort of rowing thing where they were sat on the floor and they were rowing. That was weird. That was funny.
Edinburgh.
Yeah.
And Chicago, I've had that before. The whole crowd just sits down wall to wall rowing on the floor.
Wait to piss on my Damn, I thought that was our thing.
You might have done it first, never know. So, you've said about how your songwriting has changed over the years. How do you think your sound has changed?
I'd say we're definitely not as niche as we used to be. I think we're all better musicians.
It's fair.
Better musicians playing simpler music.
Playing our instruments for the song rather than to be like virtuosos.
Yeah. We used to try and sort of show off and just sort of make crazy music because we thought we were decent at our instruments and stuff. So now it's more like for the song, I guess. It's more about the song, like it being a well-written song rather than it being, you know, incredibly difficult to play.
Encompass. Keep it in the locker.
Yeah. So that's, I would say that's how we've changed. Just, I mean, we've obviously like just found our sound. It takes a while if you like all come together as like four different musicians and you each have a different influence and in what you want to do, then it takes a while to figure out what your sound is and what the perfect sound that all four of you can make together is, and I think we've got that now.
Okay, so you guys have played Download, right?
Yes.
What was it like when you stepped out onto the stage and saw how massive the space was that you had to fill? Did it come naturally to fill the space, or were you just like, what do I do?
At the show it came naturally. On the run-up to the show, it was very daunting.
Yeah, it was terrifying.
We stood out there, didn't we, on the stage before we went on.
We did like a little sound check before we went on, because we were the first on the second stage, so there was no one there before the arena opened, so we kind of like did a sound check. We were just like...
That was pretty weird.
That was really
It's the biggest stage
weird.
We've ever played and the biggest crowd we've ever played to, so I don't think when we actually physically went on, we were nervous. I don't think any of us are. It's always just beforehand. Like, it's the lead up to it when you, like... It's only because, like, you've been wanting to play it for so long that that's what makes you nervous. Like, we've been looking forward to it for so long, so it's that anticipation of, like, you know, oh, it's finally here. I'm finally going to get to do this. We've been looking forward to it all year. So it's kind of just, like, excited, really, to go on.
Yeah.
That's all we get. That's all I get anyway, is just excited because, like, we know... We can play. We know. I know I can sing.
Sick
so
playing it.
Yeah, amazing.
Huge buzz.
Yeah. So good.
It's like, oh, who's behind me? No one.
Yeah.
I can literally twirl and dance my set away.
Yep. That's my input. Agreed.
Europe.
I concur.
Cool.
Is that everything about Download then?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well then.
Is it everything?
Is that everything on our agenda? Cheers for the interview, guys.
Nice one. Cheers.
Oh.